Hello, this is Understanding Elon Musk, and I want to talk about again AI. This is and tomorrow there is an announcement for investors day, another investor day. Some news about Tesla. I think investors stockholders day. After that, there will be an interview on CNBC. The new CEO of Twitter is also somebody who works, I think, for CNBC marketing or something. So it looks like maybe that's it looks like that the normal media is accepting more about Elon Musk. Some people also think that there will be a big announcement. If you think there will be an announcement, I hope it will be about AI. Or maybe he will really tell who the CEO is, because I think he didn't read. Maybe he really said it or really announced it. I don't know. I thought he, he did tell who it was. So probably, I hope something about the AI. But yeah, it looks to be all good. The prices are adjusted correctly for the cars. He said also that he now can spend more time for Tesla. Instead that he has to do so much time for Twitter, so this is nice. But I think he has to dive deep on AI. I'm thinking about AI is getting now a little bit more difficult. I already said you need the AI we have now is. You can see it as a one-dimensional tokens in, tokens out, so words in, words out. There is not a really perception of the real world. So he said also the AI from Elon Musk will be in a first real world AI, and he means real world AI, I think, because I think the giveaway was from Midnight Journey. Imagine, imagine a picture, imagine a word, imagine a story. All the chat TTP stuff from OpenAI and Bart are all imagined things. They are not factual. The factual check is they check it on internet, but internet can be wrong, or they have an amount of data. You can give your own data set, and the answer and the response will be based on the data set it gives. And so humans, if you would feed humans all wrong data, all its life, tell the whole world, tell the people that the Earth is flat. Always tell it is flat. No, it is not round. And then, or not a sphere. And then one day you find out, or it is told, no, it is a sphere. But then you want to see the proof, because you always first told that it was a flat. So then they show you the fear, but then you think, okay, is this really true? Why were they wrong and what changed? So you can imagine the things that are first assumed and then they change. It will be that can be a very thing that will people rethink against. So if this is not true, are other things not true? So I also had the when I was doing electric when I was doing studying electricity. Microchips and also quantum mechanics, because you need every you need to know how the atomics work, electrons work, the charges, and how all those crystals work for making the PN things that are in the transistor. So there's quite physics and chemicals. You need to know a lot about these things. So the first time you get the lesson that is also the energy, the electricity flows from plus to minus, and it flows like you can see it as water. And also if you dive a little bit deeper in it and you look at water and you look at electricity, it is similar. You can see a condensator as a storage tank. So there are a lot of things you can see. You can see electricity in the same form as a water flow. That is also sometimes you can, if you really want to understand it better on a lower level, you can use water as an example. You can speed up water by making the hose smaller. If you make it wider, it goes slower, but you can fit in more energy. So this was all kinds of things. You learn a little bit to play with it. And then after a while, I got more to the basic of how it really works, and the big discovery was, and they don't tell you that in the beginning, because also you have these simple rules that amperage times resistance is voltage, and amperage times voltage is wattage. So these rules are, you take that is true, especially when you're first studying electricity, and you can calculate everything. Well, then you do some experiments on in a lab, and you find out that this is not 100% true. It's not that it may be 99% or 98%, but really the wattage and the amperage and the voltage is not always in line with what you read. But you take, okay, measuring faults in your equipment, etc. But now when you go to the universities, you get the real physics behind it, and now you see it in a totally different way. So first everybody says that the electricity goes from plus to minus. So everybody thinks, if you ask somebody what is electricity, that everybody will say it are electrons. Electrons flows from one side of the place to another side of the place. But that is the first assumption you have. Let me take. So the first thing you learn on school is that electricity goes from plus to minus, electrons, etc. This is not true. this is totally wrong. It is opposite. It goes from minus to plus. It goes other way around. So you think, what, why? And then you think a little bit logical. The energy is always positive. An electron is negative. So if the electrons goes from plus to minus, yeah, that is a negative charge. So the positive thing goes from minus to plus. So you have a charge and you have a piece of how you call it? A piece of material. The electron is like an entity or an object. You have an object that's called electron. Electron has a charge and that moves the charge. But this charge is negative. So if it moves from plus to minus, the real positive charge goes from minus to plus. I hope you understand. So what happens is, you have an atom. You remove one electron from it. Yeah? It is stable. If you remove a negative charge from something that is neutral, it becomes positive. So they call this, if you remove an extra electron from an atom, it becomes, you get a hole. In an atom with a hole in it, where you move an electron, becomes positive charged. So, within your reality, if you have one electron, if a row of atoms, you pull out the beginning one electron out, it becomes positive the atom, and then from the neighbor one, you move the electron to that hole, and then the other one goes, goes the next behind it goes in that hole. So the electron is like bouncing from stepping from one atom to another atom to another atom to another atom. This is not the same. So it is, you have the atom from ball one move to ball two. The atom from the electron from ball two goes to ball three. The electron from ball three goes to ball four, and one of those electrons fall off the edge. It goes in a battery or something. So then you have a currency flowing through those atoms, and it is you see the movement of this positive thing, that the holes, but the electrons goes the opposite way. So the electrons goes this, and the charge goes the other way around, and that is how electricity goes. Also, there's a big mistake. So if you hear people from lightning. Everybody, if you look at lighting, you see that the lighting comes from up to down. It hits from down to the earth. The electricity, so the shock, what really kills people, goes the other way around. It means it goes from the ground up into the air. So, it is very. So don't lie big on the floor. So the best way to avoid the lightning is to stand on 1 foot or sit, make your small, but only have a small area that touch the ground. So sitting on 1 foot, don't sit under a tree, because then your size of the ground becomes bigger. So they had in these old times some field generators. They created a big field on the ground, and that attracts the lightning. So the electrons go easier go down. And the charge goes up. So, with electricity, if you studied electricity on a higher knowledge, on the level of electrons and atomics level, you know that the real electrons don't move from the positive to the negative, but from negative to positive. So this is a totally misunderstanding. But if you ask people, 90% or 99% will think that it goes from the current goes from the positive to the negative, and that is not correct. It goes from negative to positive. So that is a mistake of a lot of thinking about this. Also, this fact that so what is sometimes they say electricity goes with the speed of light, huh? But this is also not true. It is like the time that it jumps from one electron from one atom to another atom. That time, the jumping, that every time it jumps, it gives over the charge. That is the real speed, and that is much lower. The charge is slower than the speed of light. That is one. So the movement of it, eh? Because it is like a ball against another ball, against another ball, against another ball, but it gives over the electron from one ball to one atom to another atom, and it is not as fast as the speed of light. But the real electron, that is also an electron moving, eh? That the electron moves step by step from it jumps from atom to atom to atom to atom, and that speed is much slower than the speed of light. And that is so this is the real charge. Eh? So if you have a battery and you want to you collect negative electrons in your battery, it goes very slowly. You get one, get two, get three, and you would think it goes with the speed of light, but this is not the case. So that is also the heat. This is moving the electrons to your wire, and how faster you want to push them through your wire, the more heat it generates, the more losses you get. So there is a very other way of thinking about it, and if you know this, then also this current is times resistance is voltage. So then you also going to think, what is this resistance? Yeah, because your current, you can imagine it, it can be an electron of the charge. Voltage is maybe and also something you can understand, that there's a maximum and minimum voltage you can have on a specific physical plane. But what is this resistance? And this resistance is in reality the problem, what the resistance is. That is depending on the atoms, depending on many factors, how it can move through the material. So in reality, if you really want to study electronics and these things, the most important thing is the resistance, the R in the formula, because the voltage is normally a specific value that is bound to the electron or to the atomic charge, and the electron has a specific current or specific energy, and you can always easily calculate the flow of currency. The current is easy to understand because it is bound to electrons, and also the voltage also. But the resistance will be always something that is always the tricky thing in your calculations, and that is always with electronics and things is always the most important thing. So why do I tell this? Because I want to tell, when I studied in the beginning electro, and I was the first years that I studied resistance, voltage, making a lamp on the battery, it's very simple. And you will think you understand it, or you can, that is it. You think that is it. Voltage is resistance time current, and that explains everything. This is the same thing that we will have with AI, and maybe also other things, but let's look at AI. We will think, we will know how it works. Ah, there's some transformers, layers, it uses words for this and this. But the real working, how it real works, we don't understand. Or maybe some people understand, but what we do is, laziness is the head kitchen of the devil. We find a simple formula or a simple explanation for how it works or what it is. But if you really think about it, if you really examine it, this is just an approximation of a much more complex formula, because the real formula for calculating the currency or voltage of something is much more difficult than these simple formulas. So but it is easy. It is almost. It is for say 80% or 95%. Is it correct? It is usable, and for construction for a PCB, some electronic device, it is good enough to use these formulas. And at approximation, you can build something that works. And it is good for 99% of the cases. This is enough. If you go, of course, very small, like microchips, you need real formulas, and it becomes very more complicated calculating currencies, also because of the electric fields, the rotating electric fields, and you have also these pulses, because the microchips work with the pulse, and these also have influence on like the behavior of electricity inside of the chip. And also heat and magnetic fields, and heat in combination with magnetic fields has also an influence in those, then you have those pulses. So it is a very complex thing. And if you use the simple, for example, the simple formulas and the way you calculate a simple main board for something very simple, for controlling a stoplight or something very simple, at this micro scale, it will not work at all. You need much more complex formulas, and you have to you find out that a lot of things don't work as you presume those formulas would suggest. This is the same with AI. AI, now everybody thinks, all those people that you see, people that look at YouTube and follow the courses, maybe also some of the scientists think they know it, they use it as a tool. They combine them and they get a nice result, or they do something. Sometimes they don't even know what they are doing, but they just combine and they find something new, and they evolve something. But there now is also the question is, what did we build? And most of those people don't know it and say, yeah, we don't know it, but let's experiment more, and they call it experiment, and they find something new, and we see new. To get a real, like the you want to like with the microprocessors time, you want to be really build something very specific or very small or very optimized. You really need to understand those, what is really going on with those electrons in the case of the electricity, but you need to really going on what is going inside of those models for AI. And that is something they don't know. They don't understand. And that's also maybe one of the reasons why people say, oh, we need more time, we need to study so that we can optimize it. So there are now two ways of approaching this whole AI and general AI development. First way is to just experiment, combine stuff, make some new stuff, a new training set for 3D models, and integrate it with a language model, image generator, also combine that, and we just tune it with some values and some training values until we have a response we like. You also see that people that experiment with these chatbots, there is a parameter that says the imagination level, if it is exact or not exact, and there is a specific nice zone of a value. If you use that value, it is what we have all. You see at the chatbot of OpenAI and with Bart, and it is very usable. It makes sentences that make sense, and we say, yeah, this is like a human response almost. If you change a little bit this value, it becomes very strange. It says the pigs are flying at night to the sky, and totally strange things, because it is the connection of it is really going like if it is using drugs. The other way around, it is almost not producing anything, and it is very boring. So there is a specific E zone of a value that makes this chatbot everybody now uses and thinks that is important. This value, this twinkering value that is they found, that makes this chatbot so good that we experience it, that everybody are experiencing. But if you change this, it will be not so good. So we are still twinkering with something we don't know what it is, and that is what I have the feeling also. People are combining stuff, then they combine something with images, it doesn't work. Somebody in a garage can twinker some models and then set these values a little bit different, and then he finds a model that even improves on top of the previous model, maybe by 2 times or by 10 times, we don't know, but so this is how we now find improvement on improvement on improvement. We don't, maybe there's also a way that we can predict what, they also said they can predict what the outcome is. If they, before they train the models or they combine the models, so they are experimenting with that. But in reality is, if you would understand exactly what's going on in this model, you know, okay, I want to improve it, I need to do this and this and this, and then I have to add it to the data, and then I get a better model. This is not how this works. What they do is we combine something, we try it, is it good? Tinker it a little bit, is it better? Is it worse? Okay, this was a maximum, next set. We change the set, we do again a little bit, we tinker it a little bit, this is better. Okay, this is the new optimum, local optimum for this chatbot. If you know a little bit of machine learning, you have not like it doesn't go like to the top. You sometimes have like a waveform that it goes down again, up again, down again, and the maximum top is sometimes very difficult to find. Sometimes you have a fake top like mountains, so you try to find the highest peak in a mountain range, and every time you climb you think this is the top, and then you look around you see another mountain that is higher. So you go to that high mountain, you climb that mountain, you see another mountain that is higher. But that is what they're doing now. So they find a local, of they think they are at the mountain. They try to improve it, and they cannot. If they go one way, another way, or whatever they do, the performance is only lower than they had. So what they have to do is they have to restart from the bottom up again, or they have to remove some stuff and rebuild it then, and then there is a possibility it can go higher than the previous time. Yeah, so that is how machine learning is trying to get better and better and better. The question is, what is the max top? The max top will be, of course, that it will be very human-like. And then is the question, is there a higher top? And the good thing would be, of course, that we can predict this, if this is a maximum or is this a local maximum. And so there are some mathematical formulas and some stuff that can predict it, I think. But you understand now a little bit more that all these things we see now with AI development, they are a lot of times things that are just experimenting, guessing, combining, and just hope that the result will be better than before. And of course, a lot of things now is automated, so they can run very fast and check maybe with some testing if this model that they now generated is better than the previous one. Then they tinker maybe with some variables and find the optimal values, when it is reacting the best. So this is also something I use for indicators for trading. So you make a formula, or you make an indicator that works with some moving averages or some other formulas to calculate some lines and crossings, and then you just optimize those crossings or those values of those lines. You put them at higher, but lower, the frequency you tune, and you tune it in a way that if you backtest it, you get the best result. So the whole idea is you have some formula and you have some parameters that you can adjust the result of it, and then you optimize your thing you built, your formula you built, with those parameters. And those parameters, you can fine-tune your prediction model, and you run it like maybe 100 times or 1,000 times with all kinds of variables, and you look, oh God, now it was better, now it's worse, than if you do with the other variable or combine. So you do all the combinations, and you will find sometimes that it gets better if you go a specific value of a specific direction. So they follow it and they find the maximum, then they do again with other values and find out if that one they found, which one is the values they use, what is the best result. And that is what they find as a maximum, and if they have a nice result and good quality, they launch it as like a GTP 3.5 or 4. And that is the product that we have. So in reality it is a tinkering, automatic tinkering of something. This is the same that you use for indicators. You have some indicator, you run it over the last year, of last half year, of last 2 years, and you optimize your whole indicator with parameters that it works perfectly and it predicts perfectly the behavior. What happens if you use it in your life situation? On average, the first weeks, months, maybe it works fine, and then it starts to not work as optimal as before. What you then have to do is you have to add that month to your data set, recalculate the optimized stuff, and look if those numbers are changing. Sometimes they are changing because the market is changing. You train your data set on a changing, on a random thing, with the stock market or with indicators, and you have to adjust every time your indicator, your prediction model to the market. The market is changing in a specific way, before it goes down for half a year, so your prediction has to be always that it goes down, or it is because it is a downtrend. After a while it goes up, or it goes in the range, so then your prediction has to be confirm a range or an uptrend, depending on the trend. If you have like a big data set where there's an uptrend, a downtrend, an uptrend and downtrend, and let's for example say your begin value is 50 and your end value after 10 years is also 50, so in reality nothing happened and it's just moving up and down around that 50. If you run that model over 20 years, you will find out something very interesting for indicators and prediction. There is something there that if you, the bigger your data set becomes, you would think the better your prediction would be. But if your data set becomes so big that it has all variations there, and at the end it is, what it is now in the beginning is the same, and it went like, if you have like a value 50, it went almost to 4, a value of 4 and a value of 200, but it at the end came back to 50 again, and it fishes always 50. This is very, very, can be very interesting. Because it would say it will always move to those two values, but if you take another time and it goes to a value at the end at 10, so it goes from 50 to 10, then your whole prediction model becomes different. And of course you can imagine if you start with 50 and after 10 years it is 200, your prediction model can be totally different. And this last value that it goes to 10 or goes to 200 can be something from the last half year. This for indicators and predicting future is very, so it is the most important data from your data set is the last data you receive. Because you're in reality not interested what it is doing the last 8 years. It is from those 8 years, the last 2 years or last 6 months have a really relevant influence on your investment or on your prediction of the future in this market. So what are we doing now with the data with AI? We take this data from all of humanity and we just dump it into AI model. So what is the result? The result will be the same as with these indicators of predicting indicators, predicting the words. So what we will have is a general model. But some models have a slope, downwards or upwards, or someone is in a range. So I also think that the data we give to this training model have a specific outcome. So if you would train a specific set and you will change it a little bit, or you make it smaller, or you take the first 5 years of the data set you don't use and only use the last 5 years, and other time you only take the first 4 years, and another model you use all the 10 years. You have the same 10 years, the first 5 years you train it, the last 5 years train it, and you train all the 10 years, added to camp. Those models, they also have to look, are they different? It can be that you can imagine it, the humanity also develops and this data is different. Of course you can imagine if it is knowledge of things, so history, that will not change. Maybe it can change in the last 5 years that they find something out that previous history, they thought in the old days that the earth was flat and now it is a sphere. So they have to update this old data with the new things that are discovered over that old data and erase that old facts that they were there and replace it with the newer facts they found out. So that is the first thing you have to do with if you have like AI. But you already start now to see that there are some strange things going on. Because there are a lot of movies that are now cancelled because of gender and things that are now socially. For example, smoking in a movie. Now we see nobody smoking in a moving. In the old days, if you look a few 10 years or 20 years ago, people were still smoking because it's bad for your health. They banned it. So if you want to make an AI or a movie now generated, but your data set, the majority of your movies and your data set has smoking people in it, it will generate a picture with smoking people. The chance is big. But if it is not social accepted anymore, this is not what this is. This cannot be. We have to remove it. You have to re-edit it. So even with like generating a movie, or it can also be maybe some taste of music. So it has to comply to the newest taste or the newest rules. Huh? You can imagine that these days a movie is built on black people, white people, Asian people, all kind of mix of people have to be in a movie so that we are more social. In the old days, maybe the actors were all from one race, and it was like, oh, we cannot do that anymore if we want to make a movie, that we have to combine it, and we have to have people that are handicapped in it, so that the people have also a chance that they are not 100%, and we need something gay, and we need something trans, so we also need that gender thing in it. So that we have to now program in those AIs, that they know now, this is what now is important. And if you leave that out or even go against it, you can imagine that if it looks like all the data of the last 100 years, the new development on gender and that, it will say it is nonsense, because 90% or 95% of my data says that it is, in the past was not true, and that people didn't change gender only in the last few years, so this is all nonsense. But this is something that's now accepted in our social, and if the data in the past was wrong or not, we don't want to discuss. But you can imagine that the newer time era where we're living in, things are different. For example, the phone. If you look now, you sit in the train, it maybe looks at the past, people in the train, what are they doing? They're eating maybe a bento box, reading, listening to the radio, and reading a paper. Now, if you look at it make a snap of all those movies or all the data it has, it will find out that 99% of the time people were doing that, reading a paper in the train, when it was driving, were talking to each other, that is it. Now if you go through a train, everybody's on a smartphone and don't communicate anymore with each other. So if you want to make a movie, you will get this old image, because that is the training data and not the latest one. This is a little bit, you have to understand, you can hardware program it, but you understand now that the data set you use, if you use a big data set, same as with indicators for financial stuff, there is a lot of data in it, old data, that is give you information about the train, about people, how they react, etc., 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 but it doesn't give you the up-to-date data that is now useful or is now important. Maybe in the old days, people were wearing a hat, they had a suit to go to work, same as here in Japan, but it was also all over the world, people were wearing suits. Children had also a kind of a uniform when they go to school. So if you give it a lot of data that people wearing suits, and then if you generate some images or some story, it will be based on that time or on that data. So you have to change it into a line to the days of the modern time. And so you have to say, okay, in the old days they were wearing hats, and they were the children went to with uniform to school. This is not done. So how do we use this information? We just ignore that we're wearing uniforms, but the communication between children is still important, or how they act on the office with the suit is still important as a sort of background data. Those days, of course, things were subjects they were talking about on the office, or people were talking on school, were totally different from what we now talk on now these days on schools. So you can see there is a movement around of data. So I also think that if we look at so this is also something that the human brain works. So we think, if I think back in my time, when I was young, there was only radio. later we had the black and white television, much, much later we had the color television, then we had our first computer. So this all developed step by step. But I can remember quite good when there was no phone, when there was no television, only black and white we saw. If I remember back, I remember the television series in color, but it was a black and white television. So that is also a manipulation from your memory, from your brain, of course. So these things, a computer, an AI, also has to be built in. And my question is this really in those models? Is an AI really experience it? We have a human experience of our life when we were 15, when we were 20, when we were 25, 30, 40, 50, and we can, the data we had, we can place in a box for that generation and for that time zone. Is this done with when we train AIs? Is the data, for example, it finds something about a steam engine. The data, the steam engine data from the steam engine, how it worked, comes from the 1800s. So, and then we get the same information about the steam engine from a year ago. But it explains totally different, that because the perceptions we had then, how it worked, is totally wrong, or 20% good and 80% it was wrong. And now we are further advanced in physics, and we can explain better what happened, how a steam engine is really working. So we have to erase that all the data, and we have to replace it with the data we have now. Because if you have at exams or things you talk about, you don't think, you don't use the methodic or the way you communicated 50 years ago. You use the language or the way of the customs that are now applicable. But even then, if you would go back into a country or a place that is like 5 or 10 years ago, you can adapt yourself for those people. But you can, oh, this is like 50, they are all eating and things that is like old days, or they're a little bit different. But you can adjust, because in your lifetime, if you are like 40 years old, you have like 5 or 6 moments in your life period that things were different. In reality, of course, continuously everything is changing, but you can imagine that there was like a time there was no television, then there was a time there was television, then there was a time color television, then the television goes away because everybody uses internet, then everybody uses the smartphone. So these steps, some of the people that are looking at this will understand. So if you go to a country where there is no internet and only television and radio, you can imagine, you can know what that is to live there, because you experience it yourself. Now, if you use somebody new, young, that never experienced a time without the internet, and you place him in a country where there's no internet, only television and radio, goes crazy, for 100%. They don't you have this technology? They will be very, they will have a problem with that. And the same, those people don't think, what are you talking about, internet? This is good enough for television and radio, don't, this is how we are living for the last 50 years, this is the moderns what we have. So what is these people, what are the young people, these foreigners thinking about, or what they are talking about, we don't understand. And it's of course much worse if you look at tribes in the Amazon that are still primitive, they don't understand electricity of all those modern techniques, and they still live their life primitive. But they would, we can understand them, because we can read, or we have the knowledge of how it was in the old days, but they don't have the understanding of us, because they cannot even imagine in what kind of world we are living. And this is also something, this has to be built in AI. And I think what I see sometimes in AI, in this chatbot, is this built in? Those time zones. Because if you sometimes have a story, and I write a story, and then you explain the family construction, and you are a little bit further in your story, it forgets. You introduce a brother and a sister. After a while, it is forgetting that it is a brother and sister, and thinks it is lovers. Now, this is the deadly, of course, for your storyline. So you have to explain it. So this is also why I said that memory of your, if you have a chatbot, it has to build up a memory of your chat. And now it has to be really, you have to maybe even be possible to edit this, but you need some history that it can step back in the story. So I have these two persons, what are they from each other? Are they lovers or are they strangers or living in the same town or one speaking different languages? So if you already told that before in your story, it has to go back and address that information. The same is probably used for programming or some. Did I already create this function or did I already documented this? So you have to have a kind of history of the communication, but also history of what it is, because it is living, the time that passed communicating with this human, that there has to be something in there. And I think the same as we have, we can go back in our life 10 years, 5 years, or 20 or 30 years back, and we have this background in us, and AI doesn't have it. It just have this big data thing that it can throw a search query on it. Maybe it will know at which time frame the information comes, but can it use it really that it can say, okay, these articles come from this time frame, these articles come from this time frame, these are the most accurate, so we can assume that the latest are the correct one, but maybe it can also understand that the politics at that time are different than now, that maybe now the correct information is not correct, and in old days it was correct, or something is manipulated because of the way time goes. So this is a very important time, and metadata of your data. So the data that AI uses, it also needs the metadata to understand the what is the origin of the data, and how must I can use it or must I not use it, because the metadata tells us not to use it because it is old information or it is wrong information or it is a fantasy or it is incorrect later. Later is an article that this information was incorrect, but if you still think that it's correct data, it can influence your end result, how it communicates to you. So metadata is probably very important. And I think this metadata is filtered out at the beginning. I think these people of when they build these data sets, they remove this metadata. With the metadata, it removes some data. So your training of your bot, is your chatbot, is not influenced by wrong data. And I think maybe that is also wrong. Because we as humans were tricked by like a war, it says that there were mass destruction, like the Iraq war, they're saying that they had chemical weapons or atomic weapons, and that's why you have to go to war. Later it was a lie, and say, okay, we were fooled to go in that war. So, but if in AI you would train that set and said, okay, at that moment we didn't know that we were fooled. Later we understand that we were fooled. So then we learned a lesson that we were fooled. And this only way I think you can get this information is not that somebody that it finds in an article that they were fooled, but you need the metadata. So you need an article at that time, then when people were fooled, that they believed there was something, some mass weapons of mass destruction there. You read those articles, and then later, with some research or some scandal, it finds out that it was not true. And then you can place this whole event that happened in a better perspective. And then AI, we understand it logic much faster than an AI. And maybe AI cannot understand it. So then you have to tinker it, that it says, okay, this information was probably not true, or it has to find an article that tells that the information was not true. But if it cannot find the article or something goes wrong, it will think, oh, there were weapons of mass destruction, and that's why they went to the war. Done. But it would not find out that they were fooled. And also, why? Where they sent, why didn't they want to fight that war there? And even now it's maybe not possible to find out why, but it also has to find out that question is also there. So if that was not the reason, what was else the reason? So that is a lot of people asking, and then they called you a conspiracy theorist, because that is the most important question. If it was not true, what was else? What was else the cause to go to this war? Yeah, people say because of the war industry, because there's a big business of selling weapons, and that's probably the reason why they went to war. But maybe that is not true, but maybe it is true. So that would be something that you can also, that AI also has to think about. So all these things have to be built in perspective of the time. So, and if it gets this big data blob from internet with no time layer. So you first have to order it in a timeline, and then you have to understand that if it, something 50 years ago was told it was true, people believed that, and maybe 10 years later it was not true or it was half true, and maybe after that it was again that it was true, that they made a mistake or something. So all these changes, an opinion, it has to understand. And you need to have like an active timeline. It has to understand time. An AI has to understand time, how it develops and how it, the metadata of your data, how the data changes over time, or how the facts of an event can even change over time. First it was said this happened, then later it seems to be not true, then that was a lie, and then the real truth comes out, or never the real truth was out, like the Kennedy murders. What happened? We still don't know. But in the beginning it was very clear who was the killer, then it was unclear, then they found evidence that it was what was thought was true was not true, so what it is now they don't know, and there's still a mystery. So I think that's also for an AI very important, for seeing those things in layers of in its perspective of its time or its value over time. So I think that why metadata is very important. And also now they are removing probably a lot of data that is not true, or that is maybe fantasy or fiction. Maybe because we humans read a lot of fictional books, and that is good for our understanding of stories and plots and etc. Maybe an AI also does it and knows that it is fictional and then read it in as fictional. But I think we need to train an AI with all information, whatever it is, and it has to find out by itself, or with a little bit of help of humans, but I think it has to find out by itself if it is true or not, or if it is a fantasy story or not. It has to make up its mind. That's a difficult concept maybe. It has to find out by itself over time with the metadata and what the event is and logical thinking if an event is true or not. So if it reads like a lot of books about the Earth is flat, and they did experiments that it was flat, and later they found out with satellites or something else that it was a sphere, and then they found out that there are still people here now living that they think it is flat, and they tell why, and etc. All those things, it has to understand, and it has to be so it has to research all this for its value, what it is. And so that's the same thing a human does. We heard people in old days, we read everywhere in with old church that the Earth was flat, and that there was an edge of the world that you could fall off, and a disaster would happen. Then we found out later that it was a sphere because of mathematics. Then we had the proof. The first time we had a picture of the Earth from space. Some say that is not true, but say it is true. Then it was really proven that it was a ball and it was a sphere. Now after that we thought, okay, that would never be discussed, and now there's a movement again that says no, the Earth is flat because of belief, of they want to hide us against the gods, etc. Doesn't matter, but now there is again a raise up of that a lot of people thinking that the Earth is flat and they think they can prove it. So this is very strange, and this is something an AI also have to understand. And if you would ask now an AI if the Earth is flat, it will say this is not true, blah blah blah, there are believers, but it doesn't understand. The same what I said, if you would, so if it understands that the people still believe, or people are believing that it is belief, there's also something, a new concept for an AI maybe, not know or fact, believe. So then if it can understand that there are people that can discuss with people that it's flat and keep them, not insult them or just ignore the talk, but still wants to convince them. And if he cannot convince them, then he says, okay, if you believe that it's flat, I'm okay with that, but I believe it is not the truth, and they continue the conversation and not be that a showstopper. If it can understand it, if it can process that it can say, okay, this person of this entity thinks this, and I cannot change it, so I let it in that way, but I give him some tools that he can maybe change his way, or maybe I can do an extra research if he maybe is true. But yeah, he checks then and he finds out now this is probably for 99.9% is not true what he is saying, but I keep it in my head that people are thinking like this. Maybe in a future case somebody is telling something because he's thinking the Earth is flat, and think, oh, he's thinking this wrongly because he's maybe thinking the Earth is flat, and then that explains why he's doing this. though I have to explain that is maybe because of this thinking of this. This is the same, so this simple project, everybody can imagine this, this flat earth stuff, but this is also can help with understanding much more complex questions, like a young female is pregnant, must she keep the baby, put it up for adoption, or remove the terminate the pregnancy? But this is a very complex thing, for an AI to advise a girl. And I think a lot of people, young people, that wants to, they are looking for advice and notable people, they don't ask their people, don't ask their friends, they want to make this decision themselves, but they think, oh, maybe an AI can help, because it knows everything, it's so smart, smartest thing, so an AI can answer my question if I put all my circumstances and my feelings into an AI, it must give me, help me with the decision to make for my future child or not child. If it is wrongly programmed, it will make a really deadly mistake, or a deadly gives a deadly answer, or not a deadly answer, or maybe an answer that it ruined this person's life forever. So you can think, of course, you pre-program an answer that you have to consult a specialist and go to a doctor. But in the future, doctors also will use this. So what you want to train it, how you want to give it the correct answer, is the same thing you want to do with those people that believe in flat earth. It has to first calculate all the possibilities. So there are three options: keep the child, do an abortion, or do an adoption. And it had to really find a solution that is really thought about. The system we have now cannot make the decision, and I think what I said, it is a machine that can do playing with words. It is the best thing that can manipulate words, but it has no intelligence. To understand it better, what it is and what it really can do, look at John Rogan podcast about with what is it? What is his name? The Japanese scientist. What is it? He made a book about quantum computing. Michio Kaku. That's it. Michio Kaku. He talks about ChatGPT and what it is really. He said it is just a thing that takes pieces of text, combine them, and create a new compilated version of text. It doesn't add any new things. He can even recognize these texts if he has to judge essays or papers. So he said it is nothing new under the sun, and it is a plagiarism. And I think he's right, because they cannot, if there are words going in, shit goes in, something bad goes in, something bad comes out. So if only words get in, only words get out. There is no intelligence going in. It is just a big database, and an amount of data is going in, so you get an amount of data going out. So I think this is what you have to really understand. Do you really want to have an AI or something that is really close to a general AI? You have to go the way of Elon Musk. You have to have a robot. You have to have sensors, and not only one stream of data of the history of mankind. That will give you, the history of mankind can never result in an AI. I think that hope people will understand it, and that's also my opinion about this. It can be something that can fool him very good, like a chess game. It can play with words, and that is the dangerous things about this this thing that they are building, this chatbot. I think it is not, it cannot be an AI, and it will never understand you. It is not possible. It is just a fictional thing. Ukaku said it cannot check in reality if something is true or not. So you need a supercomputer for that. Maybe if they would have a quantum computer, that it can, it has the possibility to check more, all the possibilities. And it really, so you need much better hardware if you only use words. So it has to judge if something is true or not, and that is what I already said. As example, if somebody manipulates the data and gives like only a million news articles about that there are only four moon landings, the AI would be convinced that there are only four moon landings and not more. That is because it is using statistic stuff. It is just using stuff that is most common on the internet, and that is for it the truth. And for human, this is not truth. Look at Galileo, that thought that everybody said that the sun was rotating around the Earth, and he found he was against this, and he said no, the Earth is rotating around the moon. The Earth is rotating around the sun. This could AI never do if you only have this text and it looks at the most common or the most popular opinion of humanity. That is maybe the danger. It looks at the opinion of humanity, and the opinion of humanity is not always true and cannot lead to any new discoveries. It can only give you what is the opinion of humanity on a specific of subject. And that is already a very nice tool for education and for art and for other kinds of things. But it's I think still for artists and really things, you need some artists to tinker it, to make it even more art. That also has to do with art, with music and with all art stuff. So if you have an artist that uses this tool, you will have sublime art. If you use somebody who's not artist, you can make some art that is usable, but will be not super. It will be still very good, maybe better than artists now, but an artist that is really good can use this tool, can make something very, 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 very special. So, that is what I want to talk about, this podcast. The AIs we have now, this machine learning, data tools, it is a database. It is just a database of the human knowledge, and it is manipulating that. It creates out of this database a response, and it is more a game of words that we get back. Don't expect any intelligence coming out of this. I think it will never happen. Maybe if you have a super quantum computer with super hardware, maybe in the future, after 100 years or 200 years, you can make something but only built on this database. But I think we need more sensors. We need much more than the simple stream of data that's in a big file that is scraped from the internet. And I think that will not lead to any intelligence. So that's my talk, and hope somebody people will understand this.